My name is Bob Arnold. I'm a unit chief in the Macroeconomic Analysis Division at CBO, and I'm in charge of the group that creates the economic forecast that we publish twice per year. I'd like to talk about our most recent forecast, which we released in late January. The first slide shows the growth of real GDP and real potential GDP. Real GDP is a measure of economic activity in real terms, which means that the effect of changes in prices have been removed. Potential GDP is a measure of the maximum sustainable level of real GDP. It's determined largely by supply-side factors, including labor supply, capital accumulation, and productivity growth. I'd like to talk about the history in this figure first. The effects of the most recent recession that started in 2007 are quite apparent. That recession started in December of 2007 and continued through the middle of 2009. It shows up as a sharp drop in the growth of real GDP. Indeed, growth fell below zero, reaching nearly negative 3% in 2009 when measured on a year-over-year basis. That means that economic activity actually declined in real terms. Since the end of the recession, the economy has grown at a moderate rate. Real GDP growth has averaged about 2.25% per year since 2009. That growth is modest, but still faster than the growth in potential output. Focusing on 2018, growth was boosted by the stimulus that emanated from the tax bill that was passed in late 2017 and from the two spending bills that were passed in early 2018. The latest data suggests that real GDP growth in 2018 was 2.9% when measured on a year-over-year basis. The tax bill also boosted the growth in potential output in 2018 and going forward. This shows up as a slight increase in the orange line in the figure in 2018 and thereafter. In CBO's forecast, real GDP growth slows as the effects of the fiscal stimulus fades. Business investment slows in 2019 and thereafter relative to its growth in 2018, and federal spending also slows, starting in late 2019. In our forecast, real GDP is expected to grow 2.3% in 2019 and 1.7% in 2020. In the out years of the projection, we make no attempt to forecast business cycles, and we forecast that real GDP will grow at the same rate as potential GDP, which is approximately 1.9% on average. In the last slide, we were looking at growth rates. Now we're going to switch to levels. In particular, this slide shows the output gap, which is the difference in percent between real GDP and real potential GDP. It is a summary measure of the slack that exists in the economy. We'll again focus on the history first, and we can see that the 2007 recession opened up a huge output gap. Real GDP declined and fell well below potential output, reaching negative 6% in 2009. By this measure, it was the second deepest recession experienced in this country since World War II, and it implies a lot of slack in the economy. So what does this look like in the real world? Idle workers, idle factories, and very sluggish sales of goods and services by business. Since the end of the recession, real GDP growth has been modest but faster than potential growth, and as a result, the output gap has narrowed. By the end of 2017, slack in the economy had been just about eliminated, as evidenced by a roughly zero estimate of the output gap. In 2018, faster economic growth pushed the economy above potential, and we now have a positive output gap, which has implications for the forecast, which we'll see shortly. Looking ahead, we forecast that real GDP will grow more slowly than potential, which implies that the output gap, now positive, shrinks. In the out years, we assume that there will be a small negative output gap, which is consistent with historical experience and allows our forecast to reflect the possibility of a recession that might occur during the next 10 years. I'll turn now to the labor market. The next slide shows the unemployment rate and the natural rate of unemployment, which, roughly speaking, is an estimate of the equilibrium unemployment rate. The natural rate of unemployment is calculated by removing the effects of the business cycle from the actual unemployment rate. The unemployment rate generally moves with economic activity, specifically with real GDP growth. Faster GDP growth is associated with a falling unemployment rate, and vice versa. Slower GDP growth is associated with a rise in the unemployment rate. Take note first of the spike in 2009, the depths of the recession, when the unemployment rate reached 10%. Take note also of the decline in the unemployment rate after the recession. That decline is a reflection of the above-trend growth in real GDP that we've witnessed since 2009. Right now, the unemployment rate is below our estimate of the natural rate. The unemployment rate was 4% in January of 2019 and has been as low as 3.7% in recent months. The bottom line is that labor markets are very tight right now. In CBO's forecast, the unemployment rate falls to 3.5% at the end of 2019 and rises thereafter. It averages 3.7% in 2020, 4.2% in 2021, and 4.8% in the out years of the projection. And this is consistent with our forecast for real GDP growth. Tight labor markets and a positive output gap have important implications for inflation. This slide shows consumer price inflation as measured by the Price Index for Personal Consumption Expenditures, or PCE. It also shows the core PCE price index. PCE inflation is one of many measures of inflation, but it's that used by the Federal Reserve to specify its inflation objective, which is 2%, also shown on the graph. The core measure excludes food and energy prices, not because they're an unimportant component of consumer budgets, but because they're quite volatile. The core measure gives a better picture of the trend in inflation. In general, there's a negative correlation between the unemployment rate and changes in inflation. That correlation is weaker than it's been in the past, but in our estimation, still exists. And I'm going to focus on the core measure of PCE inflation. Just prior to the recession that started in 2007, core inflation was running at about 2.5%. It then declined during the recession to a low of about 1% in 2009. And since then, core has been increasing slowly as slack in the economy has diminished. Right now, core inflation is essentially at the Fed's target. It's just below 2%. In our forecast, inflation rises slightly in response to tight labor markets and to a positive output gap. Core inflation is expected to equal 2% in 2019 and 2.2% in 2020 and 2021. In the out years of the projection, we forecast that inflation will average 2%, which is equal to the Fed's objective. Turning to interest rates, the next slide shows both a short-term rate and a long-term rate. Specifically, it shows the rate on 3-month Treasury bills and the rate on 10-year Treasury notes. The Federal Reserve does not influence either of these rates directly, but the 3-month rate is very closely correlated with the federal funds rate, which the Fed does influence directly. And again, the effects of the 2007 recession are very clear in this figure. The combination of weaker economic activity and looser monetary policy pushed interest rates down sharply. The Fed pushed short rates very close to zero, and long-term rates declined by about 200 basis points during the recession and in the years thereafter. The Federal Reserve started to raise rates to remove monetary accommodation in late 2015 and have increased rates several times since then. Long-term rates, which had been drifting up with stronger economic activity, started rising more rapidly in late 2016. This was a reaction both to the stronger economy and to the expectation of higher future short-term rates. Our forecast continues that recent trend. The 3-month Treasury bill rate peaks at 3.2% in 2021 and equals 2.8% in the out years. The 10-year Treasury note rate peaks at 3.7% in 2021 and stays roughly at that level thereafter. The final slide takes a closer look at the supply side of the economy. In particular, it shows the growth of potential output and the growth of two of its determinants, potential labor force and potential labor force productivity. Potential labor force productivity is a broad measure of productivity that is defined as the ratio of potential output to the potential labor force. In CBO's projection, potential output grows at an average annual pace of 1.9% during the next 10 years. That projected growth rate is slower than potential has grown over most of the post-war period. For example, potential output grew at about 4% on average from 1950 to 1973, and grew over 3% per year on average from 1974 through 2001. So why do we project that growth will be slower than it was in the past? This is largely due to slower growth in the labor force, which in turn is due mostly to demographic factors. We project that the potential labor force will grow 0.5% per year on average through 2029, a rate that is considerably slower than it was during history. The labor force grew over 2% per year on average during the 60s and early 70s, and it grew at a rate exceeding 1% per year on average during the 1980s and 1990s. That slower growth in the labor force comes about for two reasons. First, labor force growth slows as the baby boom generation reaches the traditional retirement ages. Second, the rate of labor force participation for females is no longer increasing as it did during the period from the 1960s through the mid-1990s. We don't project labor force productivity directly, but its projected growth rate is based on several underlying factors, including capital accumulation and the trend growth in total factor productivity. We expect labor force productivity to grow somewhat faster than it has since 2008, but slower than it did during the decades between the 1950s and the early 2000s. The result is a projection for potential output growth that averages about 1.9% through 2029. For more information about these projections and how they are produced, see CBO's website, www.cbo.gov.